Well, brief mentions in other videos about the Q word. you know, the magic computers that are going to break all encryption and beat everyone at their own game and be the next big thing and be in all our smartphones. Yep. Should we put some reality on this? Where are we at with quantum computing?
I work at a company called Rigetti Computing. We're a company in Berkeley, California, and we build quantum computers from the ground up. We do the silicon fabrication all the way up to how we program the machines. I, in particular, think a lot about how we program the machines, how we interface with it. At some point, somebody has to type something into a keyboard to make it do something, and that's mostly where I think about things. Quantum computers really should be thought of as a way to augment our existing compute infrastructure. Existing computers solve problems, and that's not going away. They will continue to solve good problems. So a quantum computer really should be thought of as a special purpose machine that can solve certain problems a lot better than existing computers can solve them. In fact, I think thinking of it like a GPU is pretty fruitful, that GPUs are computers in a sense, but really they're better thought of as like a coprocessor to your main computer. GPUs are extremely good at solving a variety of problems. You could sort of wrangle a GPU to solve any problem you want to, but it's, you know, regular computers are good at that. So quantum computers I think of as like on the side. Unfortunately, current quantum computers are gigantic. They're like the old computers, like the ENIAC. They fill a room. But nonetheless, you hook your computer up to this and it does separate problem solving. As a company, we build these quantum computers and deploy them. They're accessible right now on the cloud. They're something that I, on my laptop anywhere, actually, I don't need any special interface, can connect up to them and do computations with them. And we're at a point now where the fundamental unit of resource of a quantum computer, just as we take regular computers and think about them in terms of bits and gigabytes and so on a quantum computer these are measured in qubits, which are very special because every time you add a qubit, you're doubling the capacity of the computer in some way. So last year we released a machine that has around 8 qubits, and now the current machine we have is about 19 qubits. So it's not that we approximately just doubled the qubits, because each qubit itself is doubling. So you have to think of that number of doublings each time from 8 to 19. Problems that deal with lots of interactions or lots of possibilities, so to speak, are where quantum computers sort of shine. So one big area of application is in quantum computing is the simulation of molecules. Molecules are made up of a bunch of atoms, and each of these atoms is applying a force to the other atoms, they're pushing and pulling each other, and there are just lots of ways in which the atoms interact with one another. And a quantum computer is extremely good at keeping track of all of that and dealing with that in a very efficient way that classical computers, which are normal computers, don't deal with quite as well. Likewise, other types of problems like optimization, which in mathematics means kind of finding the best or worst possible solution to a problem, quantum computers are showing a lot of promise in. With that said, though, there's one point I want to make, which is sort of in popular science, people think that quantum computers just sort of try every possibility at the same time. You get all these sort of kooky interpretations of multiple universes and so on, and quantum computers don't do that. They do not try every possibility at the same time. But the second point is that applications of quantum computing is a very active field of research. Quantum computers currently are, they're called noisy quantum computers. They sort of act like analog devices, not digital devices. And so there's all this little bits of error and little bits of noise that come into the system. And so it's an active field of research to see what algorithms and what problems are very robust to this noise. And it turns out that this molecular simulation is an example of a problem that's very robust to noise. Whereas what you might heard of like Shor's algorithm and factoring and breaking encryption are not robust to noise at all. They're very difficult to do. So that's a very active field of research, both at the company that I work at, as well as more broadly in the community. The sort of room-sized computers are sort of where we're at. The way in which these computers have been constructed is using sort of off-the-shelf components that have not been specially made for the construction of that machine in general. So you find generally with these quantum computers, you find big racks of analog electronics, these electronics that have existed for other applications. And so it's definitely not at a point where we've sort of custom fabricated the entirety of the machine. I'm not just talking about the quantum chip itself, but the thing that the quantum chip is housed in, the electronics that go with the quantum chip, et cetera, et cetera. We're only just starting, we just in general, as a in the field of quantum computation, are only just starting to make like customized electronics and the like for these systems. The other aspect of this is that just like the ENIAC, for example, which had vacuum tubes that burnt out and you had to go replace them, literal bugs getting in there and so on, neither of those things happen with quantum computers. But what does happen is that the system in general isn't shown to be stable across, you know, 5 or 10 years. It just hasn't existed that long. And so components are often swapped out, often changed. It's not robust to changes in the environment. Like if somebody walks by with a big magnet, the whole thing kind of goes awry. So it's a really sort of finicky machine, not unlike the early computers like the ENIAC and so on.
How far are we off quantum smartphones then?
Yeah, that is really, really far away because we need to cool these chips down to like the same temperature or colder than the temperature of outer space. So you need big refrigerators, as they're called. Not going to happen for a good while. The interesting thing, though, is when we have multiple qubits. And this is really where the power of quantum computation happens. And we can actually think of it sort of simply diagrammatically, that if qubits, if I just represent them sort of as a circle here, maybe we have three. The idea is that these qubits can interact. This guy can interact with this guy.